My name is Janet Marie Rogers, and I'm Mohawk Tuscarora from Six Nations territory in what is now occupied Southern Ontario. And when I'm thinking about 1492 in reference to colonization and genocide and settler nation and relationship and everything like that, it's hard pressed to find a native territory, and when I say that, I mean reserves, that don't have a strong presence of the church on the reserve. And so when I think about, you know, that kind of genocide, it's a spiritual genocide, and that's what is still very prevalent today. It wasn't just taking of the land, it was taking of the minds and taking of the spirits of the people of those lands. And so when I see that still present on our territories, I don't hear a lot of people kind of questioning that. They know that it was part and parcel of that invasion, if you will, and something that really lives in the hearts of Native people. And it seems to kind of be this unspoken oddity on our reserve anyways. I mean, you know, there's lots of churches. In fact, we have one of our tourist spots is called the Mohawk Chapel. And I think it's Anglican because those priests that came in, they were Anglican priests. And so when I think of, you know, that kind of contact, that's the contact that came with Columbus. It wasn't just the extraction of the resources, it was extraction of the people's spirits. And I don't mean to make that all sound very, you know, kind of like victim-y. It's not that, but I mean, whoever was the architect of those kinds of actions, it was just very, very clever and very, very effective. And that's the part that still, I think we're still trying to break away from or dissect and help others kind of wake up from that that opiate, the opiate of religion, as my mom says. So that's what I see happening. It was recently when I really started to look at the Arturo Wampum Law and write about that and in new ways, you know, write about it in my poetry and things like that. And it made me understand where people were coming from, our nations were coming from, and really, basically, that's all really I'm concerned and focused with. As a Haudenosaunee person, what am I representing? And when I ask that question, I'm asking, what am I representing in terms of relationships with the outside world? Are there ways that I need to be aware of to conduct myself? Mm-hmm. And at the same time, you know, going by my own gut and my own kind of psychic sense of goodness and wellness and what's good for me. But thinking of the whole community, that two-row relationship was meant to be written out of respect. It's not about hierarchy. It's not about, you know, getting one up on somebody else. It was about maintaining a relationship that was based on equality. And I think we're still striving for that. And every time that I hear Indigenous nations complain about not being treated well, I think to myself, we have everything we need to conduct ourselves in the way that we used to. We know those ways. And especially where justice is concerned, it's like we had all of that stuff, but now we're relying on the colonial justice system. We're relying on, you know, we use money and all of that business. But we had those things, and I would like to see more of those original ways kind of brought back into being, whatever that may look like or may be able to exist today. That would help us, I think, empower ourselves. We have to remember who we are. And I think part of our job as Indigenous people in relationship with outside world is to remind others who they are too, so they can feel empowered and not feel threatened, because a lot of the injustice and a lot of the fear that's going around today in North America has to do with people feeling like they're losing out. Remember who you are, and we're going to remember who we are. And exist like that.
Mm-hmm.